With plenty of opportunities in India's infrastructure sector, it is imperative for foreign companies to understand certain aspects of the Indian market before they engage in business here or work on a particular project. Even more so, these companies require appropriate knowledge about the projects from a tax and regulatory perspective. To help understand the same, we now take you to Nitin Garg, who's a founding partner at Coinmen Consultants LLP and an international tax expert. In this video, he'll be answering some frequently asked questions by foreign companies looking to enter the Indian market in the infrastructure sector and looking to execute projects related to the same. What are the typical models in which infrastructure projects are awarded?
So investments in infrastructure sector in India has picked up in the last 15 to 20 years. That's when the government realized that we need more technological solutions and investments in building up large infrastructure. And hence we saw a lot of foreign companies participating in these projects. While it was foreign companies bringing in technology and investments, they always needed a local execution partner or partner with capabilities to organize local infrastructure needed to execute the project. So what we saw was that the foreign companies were joining hands with local partners, or two or more foreign companies were coming together to participate in these projects as well as execute these projects jointly. So in our experience, we see a lot of projects getting bid as a consortium, where two or more members come together and bid for the project together. However, there have been cases where foreign companies have bid for these projects individually as well, though depending on the size and requirements of each project.
From a tax and regulatory standpoint, what are the things to be kept in mind while preparing a financial bid for the same?
Interesting question. We have seen that a lot of planning is required even from a tax and regulatory standpoint while preparing the financial bid, simply because if it's not planned, you could end up with some surprises once you start to execute the project. So I'll talk of four main things that I have seen in my experience which companies go through and they face challenges. The first and foremost is deciding on the structure in which the project, if awarded, will get executed. As I mentioned earlier, that typically the projects are bid as a consortium or individually. If they are awarded individually, it is not much of an issue because foreign companies can set up project office and execute the project. But the real complexities arise when the projects are awarded to a consortium where members have to operate as a joint venture. And hence it becomes very important to understand the implications of operating as a joint venture, both from a regulations point of view as well as the tax flow point of view. The second most important point is whether the subcontracting permissions are there in the bid documents, because if many a times what happens is that if you're awarded as a project in a joint venture, you may want to subcontract the respective scope of work to each member, and each member may want to get paid separately from the joint venture. However, this may get restricted by specific terms of each agreement or each project, where there may be restrictions on the amount of subcontracting that is permissible. You know, it can vary from 30% to 70% or even 100%, but that's one very important factor, which is again in sync with how the project is structured. The third thing is again linked to the way project eventually gets executed, because that has a direct impact on the GST or goods and services tax, which is built into the project. More often than not, the projects are bid, the project prices include GST, and hence any saving or any disadvantage in the structure on account of GST is usually borne by the companies executing the project. And hence, knowing the impact of GST in the structure becomes imperative. And we have seen that a lot of these projects have exemptions on GST while the bidders invoice to the client, but they may not have corresponding exemptions when they are procuring goods and services locally or from outside India. So the overall understanding of GST in the structure becomes extremely important. The fourth and the last important point, again coming from our experience, is the impact of tax cost and social security cost on the expats that are likely to be deployed for execution of this project in India. It is usually the case that a lot of expats get deployed for monitoring or for execution of the project in India, and there is a higher tax cost associated with the salaries of those expats, plus there are social security contributions which usually get paid and, you know, which usually becomes a cost to the project. Hence, all these four important points make impact on the financial bid, since each one of these has certain specific costs attached to it and they must be captured in the financial bid while preparing the bid.
Once a project is awarded, what are the immediate steps and how do timelines pan out?
Typically, in any of these projects, the first step that happens is receipt of advance money from the client to the successful bidder. Hence, the obvious requirement is to open a bank account, either as a joint venture or as a foreign company singly, depending on who has bid for the project. Opening of a joint venture bank account typically is not very time consuming. However, if a foreign company has singly bid for the project, it will need to set up a project office, for which it will need to provide certain documentation, which can take up to about 30 to 45 days. For receiving the advance money, one of the important preconditions is to furnish bank guarantees. Hence, it is also important that a bank with which you are most likely to open your account should be identified at the time you're bidding for the project, and you are able to understand the kind of documentation that may be required for furnishing the performance guarantees and the bank guarantees necessary to receive the advance money. Thereafter, all the tax registrations need to be done. One of the important thing which also plays an important role is that even the advance receipts may be subject to withholding taxes. And depending on nature of each project and the way the project are structured, one may need to obtain a certificate from Income Tax Department regarding the rate of withholding tax. That process itself may take about 4 to 5 weeks. Hence, on the worst side, it could even take up to 2 to 3 months before one can prepare to receive the advance money, and that may impact the overall cash flow and the timelines of the project. So it is important to understand at the time of bidding, or maybe, once you have been given a letter of award, to understand how long will it take for you to have successfully opened the bank account, as well as have necessary certificates in place to receive the advance money.
Thank you for watching the video. We hope it was useful. For more information on the topics covered in the video or for any other queries, feel free to reach out to us.